everybody. Welcome, welcome, welcome to Atlanta Live. It's good to be with all of you. I'm Rebecca Keener, your host for tonight, and it's so wonderful to be in the studios here in Atlanta, Georgia, and wherever you're watching tonight. You may be somewhere across the nation, but we welcome you in and pray that this is a wonderful encouragement for each of you tonight. And we have some wonderful guests with us. Tonight we have Rick Story, who is with Explore Raven, and he is a wonderful minister, a great man of God. He's been in the political arena, he's been in the business arena, and he also worked on staff at Samaritan's Purse and as an assistant to Dr. Billy Graham. So we're looking forward to hearing from him, and I know he has a lot of wonderful things to share. He's already opened our program tonight before we came in prayer. It was just such a wonderful time together. So you're going to really enjoy getting to know Rick Story. And some of you watching tonight may know him, and he's from Raven County, way up in the mountains of North Georgia. And we call that God's country up there. So you'll enjoy hearing all about that. And we also have with us tonight someone who's very dear to my heart, Dr. Jennifer Eichelberger, who is an author. She is a minister, and also she's an accomplished flutist, and she's going to be playing for us tonight. It's so peaceful. We were just enjoying hearing her earlier tonight as she did her sound check. It was wonderful to hear from her, and you're going to enjoy hearing about her new book, Self-Care, The Virtual Art of Nurturing You. So we're going to talk a little bit about self-care with Jennifer. And then also we have Afa Tachia, who is with us tonight. She's a great minister, and she will be sharing with us her powerful testimony. We're going to open tonight now with Jennifer, and she's playing How Great is Our God. Enjoy.
Thank you.
Thank you, Jennifer. That was beautiful, and so good to see her on the other side of the camera. For many years, she worked here with the Atlanta Live family as a producer and helped put these programs together, and so it's great to hear from you tonight, and she'll be back with us in just a moment. We're on the set, though. If you would help me welcome someone who has made a big difference in government and in also the religious mountain as well, and now in business, Rick Story. Thank you. Thank you for being with us.
Thank you for having me. Wonderful to be here. It's already been a blessing.
Well, you've been a blessing to us, and you walk with such humility. I appreciate that. And I know one of the things that really interested me, and my mom and dad are so excited that you're here. I think they're at home watching along with some of our friends in Rabun County, is that you had some years with Dr. Billy Graham.
Yes.
And let's just start there if we can and talk about how did the Lord lead you to work with, and you had been in politics
yes.
for many years,
mm-hmm.
working with Newt Gingrich, the Speaker of the House, and mm-hmm.
And then with Nathan Deal,
who
went on, left Congress to become governor, and 10 years on Capitol Hill.
Wow.
And loved every minute of it. It was my dream job. And in the 10th year, you know, God was sort of beginning to lead me away. I could feel that pull and that tug that he wanted me to do something different. I read Franklin Graham's autobiography, Rebel with a Cause.
Mm.
And God just told me when I was reading that, this is where you need to go. You will be working for this man. And I'm like, but I don't know this man. It's wonderful. And Speaker Gingrich asked me one night at dinner, what do you want to do after Capitol Hill? And I told him, I shared that with him. And he said, I will make a call. And looking back on that, what really boggles my mind is he was the only person on this planet that I knew who knew the Grahams. That was the connection, but that was a God connection. God had already planned that out. God had ordained that long before I was born. God had that as part of his plan.
Wow. How did you sense that? You know, I feel there may be some young people watching tonight, even in the studio. How did you sense that nudge of the Holy Spirit that that's where he needed you to be? How do we know these things?
Reading, praying, asking him, asking the Lord, you know, what do you want me to do next? And I loved every minute, every second of Capitol Hill for 10 years. Mm. But I woke up one morning and I felt like it's time for me to go.
Wow.
And it's like, wow, I love this place. But God said, I have something else.
Mm.
Just trust me.
Did you feel that maybe you were going to be in politics the rest of your life? Or
I did.
Yeah.
I did, and I thought I would live in Washington for the rest of my life.
Wow, that's amazing. Do you think the Lord may ever draw you back into that at some point as you get older? Or
possibly.
Yeah.
Possibly.
We'll see. His plan is always best, isn't
Absolutely.
It? Well, just
Absolutely.
Let's talk a little bit about your years with Billy Graham, because tell us your position with him. You were pretty close to him.
Right. And I was a special assistant to him. I was one of four guys that were on his personal team, and based in beautiful Montreat, North Carolina, right outside of Asheville.
Oh, that's tough.
And tough assignment.
Yeah.
And did a lot of work in the Graham's home, because by the time I came along, Mr. Graham was older. He was not going down the mountain to his office every day. So I would go up each day to his office and his home. And the blessing there, Rebecca, was not only getting to know Mr. Graham, but also getting to know Mrs. Graham.
Mm.
And he was awesome, but in her own right, she was phenomenal. Her story was just an amazing story with God at every turn, in bringing her family from medical missionaries in China, bringing them back to the States, putting her at Wheaton College, where she met fellow student Billy Graham during college.
Amazing.
And just an amazing lady. They really blessed me and treated me as one of their own.
Oh, my. I mean, that's just such a rare, you know, when you look at that, do you just want to pinch yourself that you had that opportunity?
Every day. Could not believe I was there.
Goodness, what can you share some of the life lessons that you gleaned from both Billy and Ruth?
Absolutely.
Yeah.
And the one thing that always impressed me was the strength of their prayer lives.
Oh, you know,
they prayed a lot. We would stop in the middle of the day if something was going on you know, there was never a bad time to pray. And I remember Mr. Graham doing an interview as he was retiring. Someone asked him, and I don't remember which reporter asked him, if you could go back and do one thing differently, what would it be? He said, pray more. Mm. And I thought, well, we prayed a lot, and it was great, and it was always a blessing. Mm-hmm. And just being there and sitting there and hearing him pray, you know, Holy Spirit chills were just up and down and all over. But he did say that was the one thing that he would have done more, was to pray more. And with Mrs. Graham, her faith. She was just such a spiritual giant and just had a faith that was just unsurpassed. Mm. And you know, her knowledge of the Bible. Her Bible was just marked up and down and in the margins and around the you know, curves of the verses. Mm. And just a very, very dedicated student of the Bible all her life. Mm.
Did you ever see them processing through any kind of crisis or challenge? I'm sure there were challenges, because if you're in ministry, then
right.
you're going to have challenges. But anything that stuck out in your mind and how they handled it?
Right. Health challenges, health crises, worrying about situations with the children. They always met each of those situations with the strongest of faith. And there again, they always prayed it through. I know they were concerned for their children at times. They were concerned for their own health, but, you know, never worried, just always concerned, and said, let's take this to the Lord. Mm. Let's take it to the foot of the cross. Let's leave it there. And we don't have to worry about it that way.
Oh, that's so good. That's powerful. Mm-hmm. Were you a part of, I know there were government leaders and mm-hmm. presidents who consulted with Dr. Graham. Were you ever privy to being in the room with any of that, or to be a part of it?
I was never in the room. I was there when he had some visits, but
right.
I was never in the room because I wanted to certainly give privacy
right.
to both parties and to the visitors. But
yes.
went with him to Washington. He was knighted by Queen Elizabeth, and he was unable to travel to London. So we did that at the British Embassy in Washington. That
oh.
was a real thrill
oh,
to get
wow.
to do that. And get to be part of that, and of course trips to the White House. At the point that I worked for him, we had a lot of visitors coming to see him.
Mm-hmm.
And so a lot of people coming to Monterey, but always neat to meet those people, you know, hear their story, and just get to know them as people.
My goodness. I've been to the library, mm-hmm. Billy Graham Library, there in Charlotte, isn't it? Is that
yes,
right?
Yes, in Charlotte.
And
his hometown.
Wow, what an experience. If, you know, any of our viewers have never had the opportunity to go to that library, Billy Graham Library in Charlotte, it is a treat, isn't
right.
it? Did you
Absolutely.
Get to go to that, or did Dr. Graham ever get to go?
You know, I went for the groundbreaking.
Really?
And I went back for his funeral. I have not yet toured the library. That is on my bucket list, and I'm going to go. It's closed right now for some renovations.
Gotcha.
As soon as it opens back up, I'm there.
You're going to go. Mm-hmm. It's just so interesting, all the little notes and mementos from his life that he mm-hmm. took the time to share mm-hmm. and to save,
mm-hmm.
you know, to give mm-hmm. God the glory. And mm-hmm. you are just really inspired and ministered to as you walk around it.
Absolutely. And you know, they are opening, or maybe already have opened, the new research center there on the premises. It's a new building, constructed. All of those items were moved into that building. And so they're available for young pastors or for any pastor who wants to do research, his sermon notes. It's all repository there on premises now.
Oh, what a blessing.
So can't wait to see that either.
That's wonderful. I didn't know about that.
Mm-hmm.
I want to talk about your other work as well, but just one last question. How did you feel when you learned he had passed? What were your thoughts about that?
Well, immediate sadness. My mom called me.
Mm-hmm.
I was going to an eye doctor's appointment. I remember I was in my car, and my mom called me and told me.
Yeah.
And just, you know, immediate sadness, but it passed quickly because I know where he is. You know, I can't imagine the reward, you know, believing in Jesus Christ,
yeah.
giving his life to Christ, serving Christ.
Yeah.
You know, I know he was receiving his reward, and
absolutely.
You know, I miss him, but I know I'll see him again.
Amen. And we know that, we have that assurance, because we
yes.
have received Jesus Christ as our Lord
absolutely.
And Savior.
Mm-hmm.
Amen. And if any of
mm-hmm.
you are watching tonight and you don't know the Lord Jesus, and you want assurance to know that you're going to be in heaven. And one day we'll get to meet Dr. Billy Graham.
Right.
I'm believing. Listen, just ask him into your heart.
Absolutely.
And he will come in and change your life in a great way. And
yes.
I think about how the Holy Spirit has used you in Washington on Capitol Hill and elevated you to assist some of the most prominent leaders in our nation. And then with Dr. Billy Graham, and now using you in the development in the northern part of our state, tell us a little bit about what you're doing now and about Rabun County.
Well, I head up an organization called Forward Rabun,
yeah.
And that's an umbrella organization for our development authority, our tourism authority, and our Chamber of Commerce. And it has been a real blessing. I never dreamed I would be able to go back home until, you know, many years later, until I had retired. And like I was saying, I thought I would be a Washingtonian probably for my entire career and most of my life.
Yeah.
But God opened doors, and I was able to go back and head up this organization, work for our county commission, our county government. And our commissioners have been very gracious to allow me to build this organization from scratch. We put it together, these three entities, and umbrellaed it, and they've allowed me to do that. And it's a very pivotal time in Rabun County. We're seeing a lot of growth.
Yes.
A lot of new people in our community, and certainly we welcome them, welcome that. And so many good churches where they'll find church homes. And it's just a very good time in many regards to be back in Rabun County. I'm able to be there with my parents at this point in their life, and that has been a blessing in and of itself. You know, I lived there, went to high school there, then I left. Gone 25 years. Being back there at this point in my life with my parents has been a blessing all its own, and I'm extremely grateful for that.
That is a blessing.
The season.
That's awesome.
Season of life.
Yeah. And I read in your bio that you attended Young Harris, or you got a two-year degree from Young Harris before you went on to further your education.
Right.
I didn't realize that. What did you receive at Young Harris?
It was an Associate of Arts degree.
Okay.
And my college career was very interesting in that freshman year was University of Georgia, then came Young Harris, then West Georgia. So I think it took three colleges to get me educated and get me on the right
There's
the right
hope
path.
For all of us.
Three colleges and the Lord. But yeah, that was a great experience. And love Young Harris. Was not my first choice. That was my parents' choice for me.
Really?
But it wound up being the best thing that could have ever happened. And love the place and have the greatest of memories of
Young
Harris.
That is so neat to know. My husband attended Young Harris on a tennis scholarship. His mother attended there, and his grandmother, Kitty from up on Betty's Creek.
From Betty's Creek.
In Rabun County. Are you amazed at the growth and the change of our mountains and our northern communities? And what do you see next for our state?
I am. And it really was accelerated with the COVID epidemic, the pandemic.
Yeah.
And probably our biggest charge at Forward Rabun is to manage that growth responsibly.
Yeah.
And to be good stewards of what God has given us. With all that natural bounty and those beautiful resources, I think we do have a very, very serious responsibility to manage that well and to do it right.
Yeah.
Because we don't want to mess up God's creation in any way, and we just try to manage it responsibly each and every day.
Absolutely. And so much of Rabun County is state park.
Yes.
And even national forest.
We are the only county in Georgia that has three state parks, and that's a blessing. You know, Tallulah Gorge, Moccasin Creek, and then Black Rock.
Yep, I was there a couple weeks ago.
We have a high mountain and we have a very deep hole, you know, right there in the same county, both of which are
Yeah, and when you stand on the top of Black Rock, you can see for how many miles. I don't
know.
We were trying to figure out what mountains were what, but it's just magnificent.
Mm-hmm.
Truly, we're blessed in Georgia, aren't
we? Yes, we are.
I was thinking about you being at Young Harris and how, did you imagine that the Lord would send you to Washington, D.C. and to work at the Capitol and then with Billy Graham? Mm-hmm. Just speak to some of the young people that are watching tonight and feel like, you know, how do I get my start? How do I, you know, follow God's plan for my life?
Never would have dreamed that in a million years.
Yeah.
And, you know, my last, it was quarters back then, my last quarter of my senior year, that was before semesters existed.
Yeah.
That's how long ago that was. But last quarter of my senior year in college, I was praying about, you know, God, what do you want me to do? You know, how can I serve you? How can I give you my life? And he actually told me Capitol Hill. Mm. And I thought, I must have misunderstood. I don't see myself in that arena. Got there and loved it, loved every minute of it. But just the way God put that together. And I was reading in your beautiful devotional book, today's devotional, you had a sentence in there that just really summed it up for me. Nothing with God is impossible.
Amen.
And I read that sentence and it made me smile because I thought, that's my summary statement right there.
Hallelujah.
And it just never ceases to amaze me how, you know, God used the Newt Gingrich connection to connect me to the Grahams. And it was Franklin Graham initially. It was not his dad. I went to Samaritan's Purse first.
Okay.
Went on a trip to Mayo Clinic with Dr. Graham for Franklin. He had to have emergency surgery. That's a whole nother story.
Wow.
That's how we met and how I wound up working for him.
Wow, so you worked at Samaritan's Purse and for Dr.
Mm-hmm.
Billy Graham.
Mm-hmm.
What a wonderful life.
I tell you, the probability of that happening, if we put all these scientists down the road here at Georgia Tech on this, statistically, it would be impossible to figure that up. Only God could have done it.
That's amazing. And I've got a son at Georgia Tech, so there you go. Well, Rick, what a blessing you are. I know there may be some people watching tonight that want to be in touch with you and invite you to come and speak or get to know you. How do they get in touch with you?
Certainly. I can give them my email if that's...
absolutely.
Certainly.
Yeah.
My email is very simple. It's just lowercase. It's just rickstory19@yahoo.com.
Okay.
Just rickstory19 @yahoo.com.
Excellent. And I hope you'll come back with us on Atlanta Live.
Absolutely.
It's been a joy talking to you and having you here at the studio. Thank you for making the trip down to the mountains. God bless you. We're going to go back on the music set now with Jennifer Eichelberger, and she will be playing for us the prayer. my beautiful friend, Jennifer Eichelberger. And I believe that song, there's a line in it that says at the end she was playing, lead us to a place with him, guide us with your grace. And don't we need that today? And we need that peace of God that passes all understanding. So thank you so much, Jennifer, for bringing that in tonight. I pray you feel his peace right at home where you are, and you're just enjoying our night together. Well, we want to welcome now to the set, and I'm so thankful she got here. We were praying for you to get here through the traffic of Atlanta, and God just cleared the way and made it possible for you to be here. I know that the Lord has a very powerful message through you. Our next guest is Afa Tachia. She is a minister, and she also has written a book, 31-Day Prayer Devotional for Women, and she also has a television program that airs from right here at WATC. So welcome with me, Afa Tachia. Hello. And you're so beautiful.
Thank you.
And calm and composed, even though you had to get through the traffic, but the Lord made a way. Thank you for being here.
You're most welcome.
I want everybody to hear your powerful testimony. You gave your life to Christ, was it in 2010? Around that time?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, and just kind of give people a little background about your journey to Christ.
Well, what a joy to be on here. I want to thank you so much for this great privilege to be on your television program today. I do not take it for granted. You know, this was a divine connection and a divine opportunity, and I'm so grateful. Thank you.
Oh, thank you for being here.
So my name is Afa Tachia Pace. You missed Pace.
Pace, yes. Yep.
That's my husband's name.
Yes.
Yes, and 2004, I converted to Islam. I was born a Catholic Christian, but I converted to Islam. Mm. I practiced Islam for 6 years, and the Lord met me during a very trying season in my life. I lost my younger brother. And prior to that time, we had met kind of like a prophet. And he prophesied and said that there is an attack against my younger brother's life and my life, and that my younger brother will die first and I will die next. And my younger brother died in 2010. So when that happened, the fear of death got me searching for Christ. And then in the university, I had a friend that connected me to a man of God. And that was how I gave my life to Christ and began to attend the Living Faith Church by Bishop David Oyedepo. And then I went to a Bible school there called the Word of Faith Bible Institute, WOFBI. And that was where the day we were graduating from the school, there was an impactation service where we were launched out to go and live a triumphant believer's life. And that day, they asked us if we had an encounter with the Holy Spirit, and if you desire to speak in tongues, have a prayer language. And they encouraged us, if you desire that gift, just yield to whatever utterance the Lord gives you. And I began, mine started with ba, 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 and then as I was going with the charged up faith environment, I noticed that was how I got the first utterance, and subsequently, I was empowered.
Amen.
And that was how I was filled with the Holy Spirit, with the evidence of speaking in tongues.
Wow.
And my life changed and transformed from that
Hallelujah.
Moment.
Hallelujah.
Yes, and if anyone watching me now, if you're a believer and you don't have a prayer language, I encourage you to desire
yes.
that prayer language. Because when I began to pray in the Holy Spirit, coming out of Islam, I didn't know the Bible. But then at the Bible school, they encouraged us that if you want to understand the Bible when you want to pray, ask the Holy Spirit to teach you.
Amen.
So the Holy Spirit became my master mentor of the Word. When I open the Bible, I'll pray in the Spirit and say, Lord, teach me your word. And my life transformed. I began to understand the Bible very clearly. And that was how the Lord met me, coming out of Islam. And then fast forward all the way to 2017, He called me to ministry. He has anointed me to help women change their self-portrait God's way, because I had a damaged self-portrait. So God brought me out of Islam, transformed my life, and now He says, I have transformed you. Now go out there and help another woman going through a damaged self-image. So that is my journey to how God called me into ministry. So I minister under the anointing of powerfully first the Holy Spirit and prayer. And that was how when we spoke, God connected us, because you are a great teacher and the Holy Spirit.
I love Him.
Yes. So,
and He is our all in all, isn't He?
Yes, ma'am.
The Holy Spirit.
Yes, He's our very life.
Yes.
He's our essence of being. Mm. He's the Spirit of wisdom.
Yeah.
He's the Spirit of might. He's the Spirit. When He came on the earth in Acts chapter 1, 2, 3, it says He came in as a rushing mighty wind. Mm. So He is the Spirit of power. If you are a believer and you want to be empowered, activate that power inside of you.
Yes.
You know, it's like having a gift, like this sister that plays an instrument.
Yes.
If you have a gift and you don't activate it, you don't sharpen it, if you're not trained in it, you will not operate in it effectively.
Amen.
So even the gift of the Holy Spirit is a free gift, but we have to be trained. We have to activate Him in our life. Amen. And He empowers us to become an overcomer, to become a triumphant Christian. And coming out of Islam, all the warfares I went through, how I kept finding myself going back to, you know, wanting to be associated with my old friends and even do the 5 daily prayers. It was the power of the Holy Spirit that brought me out.
Wow.
And I give God all the glory.
Ooh, do you feel the freedom? Can you tell us a little bit about what your life was like as in the Muslim faith and then now, the difference?
Oh, yeah.
And also speak to how can we minister to those in our community, in our neighborhood, who maybe are in the Muslim faith. How do we love them?
Well, Jesus commissioned us to love, right?
Yes.
And when I was in the Islam faith, I always come back to the Holy Spirit, because He is the Spirit of love.
Yeah.
He's the love inside of us that empowers us to love others. When I was in the Islam faith, there is a spirit in every religion, and that's why I'm persuaded that we don't serve the same God. Mm. The spirit behind the Islam faith is totally different from the Holy Spirit.
Mm.
Because the Holy Spirit is a forgiving system, is a loving system. But in the other religion, they don't have the freedom as we do. So ministering to a Muslim, it's you just show them the love of Christ and just encourage them that Jesus died for them, because they don't believe that Jesus is actually the Son of God.
Mm.
It's a distinctive relationship between Jesus being a Son of God and they believe that Jesus is just a prophet, not the Son of God.
Mm.
So in ministering to them, you encourage them that Jesus died for you to give you a better life, to give you a new life. You know, it's easy. Just receive Him and embrace Him, and He would change your life forever. Take you out of this dogma of rules and regulations. You have to do this and do that. In the other religion, you know, you must mandatory the 5 daily prayers. You must do your 5 daily prayers, the coverings, and all the things that are imposed on you. But the Holy Spirit does not force us to do anything. He gives us the freedom. We are free. Having Christ gives you the liberty, you know, to live life without being afraid if I don't follow a certain rule or regulation that I'll be punished or something.
Amen.
You know, so that is how you can minister to them. Tell them the simplicity of the gospel. It's not complicated. It's simple.
Amen.
Yes.
Amen. Do you feel the Lord had his hand on you even as a little girl, that one day you would serve him, you'd be a minister for him?
I did not feel that until he called me to ministry, because my dad had six children, and out of the six children, I was the defiant child. I loved to party. I loved to, I loved the social lifestyle. Mm. I used to rap. You know rap? In Nigeria, I used to rap.
Wow.
Mime songs. MC Light, I'll rap
now,
at
can
parties.
You rap something like Christian now, or?
No.
No, okay.
No, yeah.
You laid that aside.
I just pushed that aside.
Okay.
So I used to be the social daughter of my father.
Yeah.
And then, God, now I feel so unqualified, But looking at all the scriptural heroes, God never picked out someone who had it all. Mm-hmm. He'll go and pick up someone who is really messed up so that their life will be a testimony. Like the people who see me now and how I serve God, a lady came to Christ just because of I didn't minister to her nothing, she said. Mm. What Jesus did for you, I want him to do for me.
Hallelujah.
And I didn't see it then, but when I studied scriptural heroes, I see that God picks up messed up people and cleans them up inside out, and now empowers them with his spirit to go do the work.
Mm.
Yes.
Powerful, I tell you. And you have such a cloak of humility about you, the spirit of humility, and it really is overwhelming. It's the spirit of Christ.
Thank you.
And I give the Lord praise for that. I want to have you share, before I talk about your book, you have a connection with Dr. Mike Murdoch. Is he a mentor to you, or?
He's more than a mentor.
Tell me.
He's a spiritual father.
Oh.
He licensed and ordained me into ministry.
Oh, wonderful.
Last year, December 19th. Hmm. So I heard God called me to ministry under his ministry.
That's wonderful.
And the Lord, I was living in Seattle, Washington, and the Lord instructed me to start going to the Wisdom Center to learn under Dr. Mike Murdoch. And from Seattle to Texas was quite a distance.
It is.
And the air tickets were crazily expensive.
Yeah.
But then I yielded to the instructions of the Lord. Every month, I'll believe God to fly to Texas. Anytime Dr. Murdoch is having a conference, I'll be there.
Wow.
I will trust God. I'll believe God. I will sow seeds, and God will open doors for me to go there.
Mm.
And then he noticed me. He said, there's something about her.
Mm-hmm.
And then that was how miraculously God connected us directly on Twitter.
Mm.
I sent him a message, and he said when he saw my message, there was something different about it. It impacted his life, and that was how God connected us.
Wow.
So he became my spiritual father, began to mentor me in ministry. So I had the privilege and honor. He ordained me as a pastor evangelist. So I'm a licensed ordained minister under the ministry of Dr. Mike Murdoch, and that is why my teaching on WATC, my TV show, is Wisdom Moments with Afa.
Oh, I love that. Wisdom Moments with Afa, right here on WATC. At what time? When can people catch your program?
On every Saturdays, 11 a.m. Eastern Standard Time.
Oh, wonderful. Okay. And then your prayer journal. Tell us about that. I love the size of this.
Yes.
It's just right.
Yes, ma'am. Dr. Murdoch taught me, my mentor and spiritual father, that when you write a big book, then it gives people the pressure of completion. And a lot of people don't go through, they don't finish reading a book. They buy it and leave it on their shelves.
Uh-huh.
So make sure you write your book that is a pocket size that can go into a purse or a back pocket.
Wow.
So that inspired me to write this 31-day prayer devotional. And I picked up the women in the Bible who had an experience with Jesus. And I learned from Dr. Murdoch that if you want to succeed on the earth, both in the kingdom and in the world, study the success strategies of scriptural overcomers, or study great men. Study what they did is the shortcut to success. Mentorship is the shortcut to success. So that inspired me. I picked up the stories of women in the Bible who God used, and I pointed out their success strategies, and I turned it into this 31-day prayer devotional. You can go through it, and then I have some prayer points that you can pray. It's easy to read.
I love it. 31-day. We don't have a screenshot of it, but I'm going to hold it up for everybody to see. And you can get in touch with Afa at Afa Tachia, and Pace is your newly... Are you recently married?
3 years ago, yeah.
3 years. Okay. Forgive me. And that is wonderful. And yes, you'll have to give your husband our love and thank him for letting you come be with us tonight. But tell people how they can get a copy of your book or be in touch with you.
You can get a copy of my book on Amazon. Type Afa Tachia Pace and you can buy my book on Amazon. And also you can stay in touch with me on my website, afatachia.org.
Okay.
And anyone who wants to know more about me can just go to my website.
Okay. Do you do any blogs or writing on your...
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah.
Every Mondays, Wednesdays, and Fridays.
Wow.
I'm on Facebook and Instagram.
Really?
On Monday, I have Monday Manna. Wednesday, I have Wednesday. I do Wednesday Wisdom. And Friday, I do Friday Favor. I teach on there on my social media.
Oh, that is so powerful. I love your spirit. And I know you all at home are feeling the same thing. You know, that's just the Lord, really. And I just, what a beautiful person you are. And I'm going to tune into your program here at WATC Saturday mornings at...
11 a.m.
11 a.m. Amen. Well, thank you all for being with us. You're lovely, and we need to have you back. God bless you. We're going to go to a break right now, and we'll be back. Welcome back, everybody. We have had a fabulous time here on the Atlanta Live set, and our next guest is just going to finish the night with fireworks, and I just love her so dearly. She's been a producer here at WATC in years past and a mentor to me, a media mentor, and just a wonderful sister in Christ and a beautiful flutist, as you have already enjoyed tonight. So please welcome Jennifer Eichelberger. Thank you for being here.
Thank you for having me.
And welcome home.
Yes, absolutely.
This is home, isn't it?
It is.
You spent many nights a week here producing programs and doing such a great job. And
thank you.
Then the Lord moved you to the next season of your life.
Yes, thank you.
Yes. And since that time, you've written this wonderful book, Self-Care, The Virtual Art of Nurturing You. Mm-hmm. And what a lovely cover that is. And just teaching women on how to take care of themselves. Mm-hmm. So let's just start there and talk about what you've been doing since you were here on staff at WATC and how the Lord's been teaching you about self-care and how to teach others.
Well, one thing that God has taught me is that we do need to take time and take care of ourselves, you know, mind, body, soul, and spirit. Jesus, I tell everybody, you know, they say, okay, what's this whole thing about self-care? Well, Jesus took time off. God rested. Mm. So if Jesus took time and if God rested, why can't we take time off? You know, we almost wear it like a badge of honor. I'm doing this, I'm doing that. But we need to rest. And that's what I did the first 6 months or so. I just rested, spent time with the Lord. I had no excuse, nothing to take my time away. And I just, you know, I would have Bible study, read the Bible 2 and 3 hours just about every day.
Wow. Mm-hmm. So wonderful to have that time, isn't it, to be able to do that?
I enjoyed every second.
You know, it seems that the Lord takes us through seasons, doesn't mm-hmm. he? Seasons mm-hmm. where we're just go, 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 mm-hmm. and then a respite. Mm-hmm. And mm-hmm. is that what you found God really gave to you to be able to birth this book?
Yes. At that point, I wrote that book about 3 years ago. I was absolutely burnt out. Mm. I said, okay, God, what do you want me to do? And he said, rest. Mm. Just rest.
That's good.
And so that's what I did. And I would take notes mm-hmm. and write down these notes. And next thing I know, it's a book.
Wow. Well, so many great nuggets through here. I haven't had the opportunity to read it yet, but mm-hmm. I look forward to it. Mm-hmm. And just learning, but what would you say is your number one nugget that's close to your heart from this book on rest?
I would say just do that, just rest. Mm-hmm. As they say, just do it.
And how do you do it, though? In the day that we're in with cell phones and phone calls and emails and distractions and social media, how do you do it?
You have to turn that phone off. You have to turn the television off. You have to turn these things off because, you know, we live in a 24/7 world now. You can go shopping, you know, 3 or 4 o'clock in the morning. You can do anything now. And so you have to make a concerted effort to turn the cell phone off. Get off social media. Because otherwise, because I think studies have shown that if you are watching social media, television at night, it interrupts your sleep. Mm-hmm. And that's another thing I want to talk about, too, is how we say, oh, well, I can multitask. Mm-hmm. That interferes with your short-term thinking, believe it or not, because mm-hmm. it teaches your mind that you don't have to focus on something very long.
Yeah.
And it's like, kind of drives me crazy, like if I'm on a Zoom call or something and somebody else is on several other calls and they come back in and say, oh, what did you talk about?
Wow.
And you have to stop and go back. And so, no, we have to rest.
Yeah.
Because if you don't, it will affect you,
mm-hmm.
your health.
It will affect your health.
Yeah.
That's so true.
Yeah.
Amen.
Yeah. Yeah.
Well, I know that the Lord's using you to go out and speak to women's groups, mm-hmm. and you also minister at your church in the women's ministry mm-hmm. and done that mm-hmm. for many years.
Mm-hmm.
And we'll share your contact information so okay. folks can get in touch with you. Let's talk about our mutual friend, Dr. Pauline Plummer, and you just came back from being with her in Israel.
Yes.
Tell us a little bit about your trip
goodness.
And what's coming.
That was such an amazing trip.
Mm.
I've been to Israel before, but this one was different. I had an encounter with the Lord like I had never in my life, you know, on the Sea of Galilee. It's like I could feel his presence.
Wow.
I mean, literally feel him. Mm. The Wailing Wall.
Yes.
It was, all I could do is mm. just at that wall, and I was just weeping and just crying.
It's a great experience.
Yes, it is. And then the sea, the Dead Sea, mm. which is 1,200 feet below sea level. That's the lowest point on earth.
Oh, think of that.
That was amazing. And
did you get in it and
yes,
float?
Yes, you can get in it, you can float,
yeah.
and you can put the mud on you, and uh-huh. it softened your skin. So it was just amazing.
That's good self-care.
Mm-hmm. That is.
Just a trip
Absolutely.
To see something different, and
mm-hmm.
and it does change your perspective about the Bible forever,
Absolutely.
Doesn't it?
Absolutely.
Every believer needs to go.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
We climbed one mountain from, let's see, Psalms 120 to 134, I believe. That's
wow.
the Psalms of Ascension. And so we climbed the mountain from which one Psalms 121 was penned, and it just gave me a whole different perspective.
Oh,
it just
powerful.
Absolutely. I will lift up my eyes unto the hills. And you know, this is a question, I never realized it was a question, from whence come my help? My help come from the Lord,
okay.
which made heaven and earth. And then there's a part where he will not suffer thy foot to be moved. Well, when you're climbing this mountain, it's pretty steep and it's not a wide place. And you can slip if you're not careful. And just to say, oh my goodness, God kept them.
Ooh.
Yes. Oh, it was just so
powerful. Oh,
absolutely. Absolutely.
And there was a meeting there with Dr. Pauline and
yeah.
all the Covenant Daughters at Magdala Hotel.
Yes, right? The First yeah. Ladies. Her first luncheon for First Ladies at Magdala. The hotel is called Magdala, named after Mary Magdalene. That was awesome.
Powerful. Now, there's yes. a trip coming up this summer.
There's a trip.
A Women of the Bible tour mm-hmm. that Dr. Mm-hmm. Pauline and Covenant Daughters, including you and the whole team, mm-hmm. will be sponsoring. I'm hoping to go. She has extended the invitation for me to go, and I mean, it is a life-changing experience. I've only been once, and I mm-hmm. want to go back. Tell
it
us
is.
About the tour this summer.
Okay, it's in July of 2023, and if you want more information, you can go to Covenant Daughters or Pauline Plummer on Facebook or Jennifer Eichelberger on Facebook, and I could just forward the message to her. But it's next July, and she has some amazing things planned.
Yeah, so you just tour around Israel to significant places where women of the Bible
yes.
Were actually living and either following Christ or following the Lord. And what a great experience mm-hmm. that will be.
Mm-hmm.
I know you're looking forward to that.
Mm-hmm.
One thing that just Pauline has taught me that she's really learning in Israel is Shabbat, mm-hmm. which goes right along with your book.
Yes.
And what you're teaching. I think the Holy Spirit is speaking to us about this particular issue, self-care mm-hmm. and rest right mm-hmm. now. Do you sense that in your own ministry?
Absolutely, because on Fridays, they shut completely down.
Yeah.
They shut completely.
At 5 or sundown?
Yes.
Okay.
Completely. And they have dinner.
Yeah.
With their families. So mm-hmm. that's something she's trying to get us to do.
Yeah.
Because, you know, we go. And like I said, we wear it as a badge of honor, thinking that we have to go. And God doesn't require all of that of us. If you read His Word, He calls us to rest.
Mm-hmm. And then Shabbat goes from sundown Friday to sundown Saturday? Is that
yes.
usually how?
Yes.
And, you know, you think about it, we say Sundays, most of us who mm-hmm. are Christians, we mm-hmm. say mm-hmm. that Sunday is our day of rest. Mm-hmm. But if you're in the ministry or pastors who are watching us tonight or ministry leaders like yourself in a mm-hmm. church, you know.
Yes.
That's W-O-R-K.
Yes, work.
That's work. And so you've got to have that day that you set aside, don't you?
You do. You absolutely.
Yeah.
And another moment that we had, like the Sea of the Sea of Galilee, I was just sitting there and just enjoying listening to the waves and look at that. I said, wow, this is a powerful self-care moment.
It really is just mm-hmm. to be in the moment.
Mm-hmm.
Because
mm-hmm.
sometimes we're tempted, look at your phone, see who's mm-hmm. trying to connect
mm-hmm.
with you.
And mm-hmm.
that really has changed our ability to rest,
mm-hmm.
hasn't it?
It has.
Yes. Well, and you gave me a little gift bag, and I noticed in it had a candle and a bath bomb and a little comfy socks
mm-hmm.
and my book.
Mm-hmm.
And so, you know, those little things like that kind of are little reminders to rest,
mm-hmm.
aren't they? And rest in our soul.
I call that my little self-care, you know, bag. So
yeah, I love that. And you are married to Dr. Eichelberger, who is also in education. He's
mm-hmm.
poured into many, many students in the Atlanta
yes.
area at Clark University. Do you see how the Lord has used both of you to just pour into this next generation?
Yes, he absolutely loves it. He's teaching basically more online now, but he goes in maybe once a week. But he absolutely loves it. He
yeah.
said he wasn't going to retire anytime soon.
Yeah.
So.
But now to have the longevity that he's had to practice some really good self-care
yes.
and unplug.
He does.
Yeah.
Yes, he does.
What is next, do you feel? What do you feel the Lord has next for you, Jennifer?
I am just allowing God to just lead and guide me to, you know, what he wants me
yeah.
to do.
Yeah.
Yes.
I pray more books in you, too.
Another book. I'm working on a A journal.
Yeah.
Working on a journal.
Wonderful. That goes along with self-care?
It goes along with self-care.
Okay, awesome. And tell everybody how they can get in touch with you, if even for your musical gift, to come and play the flute.
Facebook would be the best way, Jennifer Eichelberger.
Okay. Mm-hmm. And they can message you on?
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Okay, awesome. Mm-hmm. Well, you have been a great blessing to so many women. I know there are people watching tonight. Mm-hmm. I want you to pray us out and pray for everybody watching. You've been a great mentor to me and a wonderful friend through
Thank
the years.
You.
Thank you for who you are in Christ.
I feel the same way.
Thank you
so much.
Pray for the ladies at home and
sure.
gentlemen as well,
sure.
that they'll be able to do better self-care and rest. Amen.
Father, we just come to you today in the name of Jesus. Oh God, we give you praise, we give you honor, we give you glory, and we thank you, for this is the day that you have made, and we will rejoice in it. Lord God, teach us. Teach us how to rest, oh God.
Yes.
Order and direct our steps, oh God. Let us know, Lord God, prioritize, Lord, what we should do and what we should do for you, oh God. Lord God, you have given us these gifts and these talents, but we should rest as well, oh God. We thank you for the gifts and talent. We thank you for healing for those who are watching this show right now that
yes.
needs healing. We thank you for those that need to know you as their personal Savior, Lord God. We thank you, Lord God, for all the wonderful things that you have done. We thank you for the opportunities that you have given us, oh God. We thank you, Lord God, for keeping us, Lord God.